I know Luna's worked at Oxford, then Queen Mary, and UCL. So it's all academic career, right? There is no industrial bias in any.
You'll be surprised then. Oh, your presentation.
All right. Okay, so then we hear about it. And the talk will be on molecular non-rigid 3D capture. So your time, please. Thank you.
Thank you. So there's a little maybe giveaway of the industrial connection just at the bottom left, but a bit more in a while. So I've titled this talk Monocular Non-Rigid 3D Capture, The Road to Commoditization. I can't even say that word, it's a bit long. I'm not even sure if it really exists, but maybe, you know, I think that the point that I wanted to make from the beginning was that we've come a really long way with computer vision. We've all got mobile phones, we can take pictures of our children. These are my two lovely daughters. And, you know, we can do a lot of 2D tasks on images, right? So now, on our phones, we've already got lots of commodity software and apps that allow us to do 2D applications. So that's really come a very long way. You know, maybe sometimes the applications go through finding some key points in the image. You can kind of do some facial analysis, facial expression analysis. You can definitely detect where the face is. So all of this is now commodity. We've all got this in our phones, in our pockets. But what hasn't actually happened quite yet is for this to become a commodity. So for, you know, real dense 3D shapes, for us to be able to get these directly from images and to be able to do this, you know, easily on our mobile phones. So this is the kind of road that I want to take you through today. So how do we go from the very early monocular capture systems towards these kind of dense, non-rigid reconstruction algorithms that can, you know, very soon start to really work everywhere? They can be ubiquitous and we can take them with us on our phones, or, you know, we can even run them on very complex videos. So this is something that the film industry has wanted for a very, very long time, right? And of course, they've had to do with many shortcuts so far. So, you know, to be able to do these animations, you need to be able to reconstruct these non-rigid faces. I'm not sure if the music's going to come on. Maybe we can turn the volume down. So we have to reconstruct these 3D faces. And so far, you know, in industry, this problem is not solved at all. And therefore, there are many shortcuts that have had to happen. And here you can see some of them, and I'm going to go through them in a second. So the first shortcut that the industry has had to solve is the problem of data association. So of course we want to be able to track the points in the image. Of course that's a very hard problem to do, and an easier way to do it is to actually put some markers physically on the face, and then we'll be able to track them through the video. So the use of markers is shortcut number one. And this is really to solve the problem of data association. And of course, you know, this is horrible. The actors absolutely hate it, and they have to go into the studio. They have to put the markers on. It takes them forever. So, you know, wouldn't it be great if we could remove the markers to be able to do this properly? So the second challenge is that reconstruction from monocular video is an inverse problem. So there's actually many different 3D reconstructions that could give us the same points in the image. And of course, you know, what the industry has done is to also introduce another shortcut, which is to solve this by using multiple cameras. So if we now have lots of cameras that are looking at the person at the same time, of course, we can triangulate and we can find out the positions of those points in 3D. So we've kind of turned a non-rigid reconstruction problem into a rigid reconstruction problem by using multiple cameras. So, you know, this is one of the typical studio for mocap, but they can get even more complicated and very kind of technologically challenging to set up. So these are studios where you've got combinations of cameras, of mocap cameras as well, maybe even 3D depth cameras. So, you know, the difficulty with this is that these studios are very, very difficult to maintain. So, you know, we want to do away with this as well. The third challenge is quite an interesting one from my point of view, which is that different types of objects or different object categories will deform in different ways. So we kind of need different deformation models depending on what we're looking at. So if we're looking at humans, then you know we can build a model of how a human is deforming. If we're looking at faces, then you know we can build a model of how the face deforms or how the shape deforms depending on each different individual. So this is another shortcut that's been used. I mean, I kind of see it as a shortcut to me. So you know, we can use object-specific pre-trained models, and then we'll be able to track these objects much more easily. Now, the kind of wicked part of this is that if we're stuck with these pre-trained models, then of course we need to recognize first what we're looking at. So if we're given any scene, any video, first of all, we need to find out, you know, this is actually a person, and this is the full body, or this is the face. But if we find a cow, then we might not have a model for a cow, right? So we won't be able to reconstruct that. So we can be limited if we just go for object-specific pre-trained models. Although, of course, if your domain is only faces, then, you know, great, it's the best thing to do. And I'll show you why a bit later. Okay, and the fourth challenge is perhaps the most important one in 2018. So the fourth challenge is that although we have lots of annotations for images, so that's, you know, the computer vision community has worked incredibly hard over the last, you know, maybe 20 years to harvest many, many annotations, but almost always these are 2D annotations. So you'll find, for instance, if we're looking at human pose estimation, that we have, you know, lots of images where you've got 2D pose. But what we really don't have enough of are 3D labels, right? So images that have 3D labels associated with them. So each of these 3D reconstructions is associated with the images that you see there at the left. So these are actually very, very hard to come through. So these are easy, and these are very hard to come through. So this is really a big challenge, and what I'm going to show you today is how to try and solve this problem of going directly from images to 3D models by doing two different things. One is trying to solve this in a completely unsupervised way, so not to use any training data at all, and use optimization methods, energy optimization methods, to solve this problem. And the other line of research that we're following at the moment is also very related to what Timor was saying before, is actually trying to look for maybe easier ways to supervise these systems, and in particular try to only use maybe the 2D labels that we do have available instead of going all the way to 3D labels. So this brings me to the kind of summary of what I'm going to present right now. So first of all, I'm going to focus on unsupervised and model-free methods for non-rigid surface reconstruction. And here you can see that, you know, the key point that underpins everything that I do is that we always have just a single camera. So we don't have a collection of cameras that are looking at the scene, we just have a single camera, and we have a deformable object. So we want to reconstruct, in this case, we have a face. And what we want to do is to reconstruct densely, so to get reconstruction for every single pixel in the image. But what I'm going to show you is a method that's model-free, so we don't have a pre-learned model of how this object is deforming. So this is the first bit of work that I'm going to tell you about. The second bit of work is some very recent work that we've been doing on estimating the human pose, so 3D human pose from a single image. And the very important thing about this work is that, you know, we're using deep learning, of course, like everyone else does these days. But the most important thing is that we don't actually have images associated with 3D labels. We only have 2D labels. And you know, I'm going to show you how can you actually solve this problem of going to 3D from a single image by using only 2D labels on the images. And then finally, I want to show you something really nice that we've started working on right now. So we've started working on SLAM systems. So these are simultaneous localization and mapping systems. So we're trying to reconstruct the scene and at the same time we're also tracking the position of the camera. But what you can see is that we're also doing this semantically, so we're also segmenting the objects and assigning semantic labels to them. So we know that this is a bottle, we know that that's a teddy bear, but we're also tracking two different motions here. So this is a dynamic SLAM system where we can track not just the motion of the camera, but also other independent motions of other objects. So this is very recent work, and I'll give you more details about this later. Okay, so we're going to start with work that we've done on non-rigid reconstruction, and this is model-free and it's completely unsupervised. So this is the work that really inspired us. So this work came out in 2014, and at that time it was really quite amazing. So this is an RGBD camera, so the input is not just the depth an RGB video, but also the depth images associated with them. And they're reconstructing this face in this case as it's deforming over time. This system is actually real time because they implemented it on GPUs and it runs very fast. And of course, my question at the time was, can we actually do this but without the depth channel? Can we just take an RGB channel only and come up with this kind of reconstruction? So I'll show you the results first. So of course the answer is yes, we can do it. Otherwise I wouldn't be showing you if it hadn't worked. And this is work that we published in ICCV in 2015. So here the only input is the video. So we just have that video sequence, and this is kind of the level of reconstructions that we can get. The important thing to note here is that this is a system that, in the same way that the previous work that I showed you from SIGGRAPH 14, the first thing that we do is that we have a short subsequence where the object is rigid, and we build a template, and then we track from there on. So how does this algorithm actually work? So the way that it works is that we've built a template in the first few frames. So we have a template of the object, and we also have a color associated with every vertex. And now, of course, the problem is we have a current live frame that comes in, and what we want to do is to estimate a warp field, a 3D warp field, so lots of 3D vectors for each of these vertices, so that we can deform them in the right way to match the current image. And as I said before, we solve this in an unsupervised way, so we don't actually have any training data here. What we're solving is an energy optimization approach where we have the classic thing, just the data term and some regularization terms. And these are quite easy to understand, these data terms and the terms that we're using in our energy. So the first thing that we want is that if we've actually got the reconstruction correctly, when we reproject back a pixel or a vertex back onto the image, then they should actually have the same color because we've established the correspondences correctly. So this is what we're minimizing. We're minimizing a photometric error. This photometric error says that if I've estimated the deformation correctly, then things should look exactly the same. They should have the same color. So that's our data term. Then we have two regularization terms that the only thing they do is to make our solution a bit smoother, and also we're able to kind of solve this very hard optimization problem with these regularization terms. The first one is, we call it as rigid as possible. It's used a lot in the graphics community. And here what you say is that if you look locally at a surface, then the deformations are actually just rigid transformations if you look very, very locally. So we impose this constraint. So what we're going to preserve here is local rigidity. And then we add a total variation term, and this, what it just says is that, if a point is in a particular place, then its neighbors are probably going to be somewhere close to that, and they're probably going to deform in a similar way. So their deformations are kind of governed by the neighborhood. And this is the total variation term.
So how do you choose the lattice of points, the grid of points?
Sorry?
How do you choose the grid of which where it places?
Yeah, this is a mesh that we create when we create the template.
Okay.
So the template actually has the neighborhood structure is given by the
3D. Is that 3D model?
Yeah.
Because you said you just have RGBD. No, RGB.
RGB, yes.
Yes.
But I said that right at the beginning, we, from a few initial frames where the object is rigid, we build a template. Sorry?
The camera is static.
Oh, the camera.
Oh,
either the camera moves, either the camera moves and the person is static, or the other way around.
Okay, so it is,
it doesn't matter.
I was thinking that just one camera is static and object static.
No, if the object is static, then
exactly,
you're probably not going to.
Okay, all right.
That's
next paper.
Well, I mean, yes, you can do it if you've seen many, you know, of course, if you use a learning approach, and you'll see some of that afterwards. So you have to have a few frames where the object is rigid. I mean, something that we're trying to get rid of right now is, you know, not to have, for the object not to have to be rigid for too long. It's complicated, though. If you want to be completely unsupervised, it's a really, really complicated problem. Of course, if you know that you're reconstructing faces, then you're much better off using a model. But if you want to, you know, reconstruct soft toys, which, you know, is a great thing to do. I guess our motivation is always that, you know, we want systems that are flexible, that we can use for any kind of objects. Okay, so here is the final results. So this system actually works at 1 frame per second right now, but we haven't actually ported the optimization to a GPU. So it's working quite nicely, but the most important thing is that, of course, the same algorithm works on any kind of object. And, you know, the other important thing is, you know, that it's actually tracking quite strong deformations. And you can kind of see here with the hand, so these deformations are actually very strong, and despite that, we're still able to reconstruct them. Okay, so, you know, we were quite happy, actually, with this system, but we wanted to take it a bit further. So this is work from one of my former students from Key, also in collaboration with Microsoft Research and with Chris Russell. And so we thought, okay, you know, we've got these reconstructions, but the detail here is not very high. What we really wanted to do was to recover high frequency details. And of course, to do that, you know, the image is actually encoding a lot more information that we're not exploiting. So this is what we did. We actually went back to the images and we tried to understand, you know, why aren't we actually getting all these high frequency details? And here is the reason. So the first thing is that, I hope you can see this. So we've taken 2 vertices. This is a mesh that has been created synthetically. It's a synthetic mesh, and then we've projected it. So we've got a synthetic sequence. And this is a purely Lambertian surface. So then what we're seeing here is the color of these pixels over time throughout the video. So that's kind of, you know, that's the video. Here's those 2 pixels highlighted. And you can see that I said at the beginning that we were minimizing this brightness constancy. We wanted to minimize photometric cost. So we were asking for the pixels to have the same brightness before and after the deformation. And you can see here that that's not actually true. It's not happening. So we're imposing something that's not really happening in the real world. And particularly if you look at this pixel here, you can see that it's changing a lot. And the reason why it's changing is because of shading effects. So because these are non-rigid surfaces, then the surface normal is changing a lot over time. So the way in which it interacts with the light is causing lots of shading effects. And of course, we didn't actually take those into account. So if we just minimize brightness constancy, then, of course, tracking is going to fail. So when we applied it to this sequence, even though it's a Lambertian surface in this case, you can see here that in the mouth, we can't actually recover the details at all. So the tracking is actually failing quite badly. So, of course, what we had to do was to go back to our model and to look at, you know, using a different model, a richer model that could explain all of these effects. And this is what we did. And I'll explain, you know, this is the reflectance equation that probably, you know, a lot of you are familiar with. So intensity can be, the intensity in the image can be decomposed as the product of two things. One is the albedo, which is the kind of intrinsic color of the surface, and the other thing is the diffuse shading. And the shading comes again from the interaction of the illumination of the light with the surface normals, with the normal directions. So, as I said before, if the normals are changing a lot, then of course the shading is changing a lot and the brightness won't be the same over time. And we've also added another part, which is that we can also have specular highlights. So now the cool thing is, on the one hand, you know, we can model specularities. We can also model the illumination. Of course, we can still model the changes in normal directions, and we can also model the albedo. So now we've got more power, but unfortunately, we've got many more parameters. So now we've got to estimate the parameters of the illumination and also the specularities, the specular component of this surface. So again, in this case, this is all unsupervised, so we just have an energy optimization approach. We minimize this kind of massive energy, and we can then obtain all of these parameters. And just so you see the difference that it makes, this is the same sequence again, and this is the result that we got with the old method where we were minimizing brightness constancy. And now, you know, with the new model, we can actually really recover the high frequency details, but also the tracking is now working. Now we're actually getting really good tracking. But this is probably even more interesting. So now we can also change the illumination, and we can also have specular surfaces. So now, you know, that sequence is just almost impossible to track. You can see here how badly this works. And if you use our method, then you can recover surfaces that look quite nice. And the tracking is actually very good as well. You can see that by looking at the next video. This was one of my dreams, to be able to just take some video of, you know, my kids just doing some silly expressions and recover these reconstructions where we've also added the texture, which kind of shows you that the tracking is really working over time. Okay, so these are just the normals, so that you see the shape and the high frequency details that we can recover. So we've kind of got quite far really, and you know, we're now able to solve quite a hard problem, and quite a nice way. So here's another video. This is a sequence that is kind of a sequence that a lot of people use in this community, and we're recovering very nicely all the details. You know, of course, the important thing is that we're recovering all the wrinkles and everything, so that's very cool. Okay, so you know, this is unsupervised, it's model free, and you know, you can get so far with these kind of models. But if you actually know that you're going to be solving a problem where you're always going to be looking at the same object and it's the same object that's deforming, then you know, why not actually use models in this case? And so now I'm going to talk about some work that we've done recently on reconstructing the human pose, and reconstructing it both in 2D and 3D. So the problem here is that we're giving a single image. We have no temporal information in this case. And we want to discover where the 2D joints are in the image, and at the same time, what their 3D coordinates are. So we're trying to solve these two problems, and we're actually solving them jointly. And we're doing this for a reason, which is that it actually improves both estimations if we tackle this problem jointly, if we try to solve this problem simultaneously. And in fact, you know, we have actually seen an improvement in the finding the 2D joints when we use 3D information. So this is some work that we had last year at CVPR. Okay, so if you look at previous work, so all of the these are all very, very recent methods that try to solve the same problem. They've got a single image, they want to get the 3D skeleton. So what do? they say, oh, you know, let's use some 3D labels. So there are a few data sets where you've got images and the associated 3D skeleton. So then, of course, you know, there are lots of different ways in which you can throw this into a CNN, different kinds of architectures, and, you know, you can get really good results, quite good results. For this, of course, you need to have the positions of, sometimes you need just the images, sometimes you need to have the positions of the joints in 2D. So instead, what we wanted to do was to solve this simultaneously, both problems simultaneously. And what we wanted was not to be able, not to need any 3D annotations on the images. So we noticed that, of course, there are, you know, millions and millions of images that have 2D annotations already. So there's been a massive exercise in the computer vision community to collect these. And these are easy to get. If you even wanted to harvest more, it's easy to get people to just click on an image and just find some joints. Now, what's really hard is to be able to associate those images with skeletons. So instead, what we did was to say, let's just take 3D mocap data. So we don't know what the images are that are associated with these. We just have the mocap data. And these are the two independent sources of training data that we have: images with 2D annotations and just mocap data. And what I'm going to show you and what we wanted to show in our work was that if we actually, you know, if we learn a model of the human pose, so if we can learn a model and we can learn how to lift 2D poses into 3D, then we can actually feed that information back into the process of finding the 2D landmarks. This is exactly what we did. So the first thing that we did was that we took all the mocap data, we aligned it, and we learned a probabilistic 3D pose model. So this is just a visualization. And here you can see that this manifold or this probabilistic model, for instance, it's got kind of clustered all the standing up poses over here. It's got some lying down poses over here or crouching. So it's kind of, you know, put the data in the right place, and it's clustered together poses that are similar to each other. So we've built this manifold. And what we've done is that we have a method by which, if we knew the 2D landmark positions, then we can actually go from 2D, this probabilistic 3D pose model allows us to go from 2D to 3D. So we can actually lift any 2D pose into 3D via this manifold by solving an energy optimization approach. So this, we call this 3D lifting. This is why our paper was called Lifting from the Deep, which is quite an inspired title, I thought. Anyway, just a few more details about this manifold. In fact, it's actually a mixture of PPCA models. So each of these is a PPCA model, a probabilistic PCA model, and then we have a mixture of them. So we kind of cluster all these kind of different clusters of poses. And as I said before, now, if we actually have some input 2D landmarks that we've detected somehow, then this model, via this optimization approach, allows us to lift the pose into 3D. So we can go from 2D to 3D. So that's great. And that's exactly what we wanted to embed into our CNN architecture. So this is how our CNN architecture actually works. So we take an image as input. So here's one of the images. And we first got some, you know, some convolutional layers and some layers that are doing feature extraction and are actually doing some 2D prediction for the belief maps of where each of these joints are located in 2D. So this is all, you know, just kind of looking at the image and trying to do some prediction based on appearance, finding out where the 2D joints are. Now, given these 2D joints, something that we can do is that we can give them to our probabilistic 3D pose model, and we can project them, we can back project them into 3D. So we can lift this into 3D, and then we can project them back onto 2D. So now we've got another set, we've got a second set of predictions that have actually gone to 3D and come back to 2D. So these have actually been reconstructed. They've actually been, they've kind of been somehow understood by the by this manifold. So they've been, you know, there's been some regularization that's been happening there because we've made them fit the manifold data that we have, and they've come back into 2D. And now we've got two different sets of belief maps. Ones have gone into 3D, the other ones haven't. And we fuse these, and now our loss is on some kind of combination, weighted combination of these two. So the important thing to note here is that we're kind of combining two different losses, but the loss, the final loss is only on 2D landmarks. And that's really the great thing about this method. The great thing is that we've been able to push some 3D information into the network, but we're only requiring 2D labels. And that's the kind of nugget of information about this method that's really important. Now, just a technicality, this is actually a multi-stage architecture, so you kind of have to, you know, you take the output of one stage and you feed it into the next stage, and you do that a few different times. You know, this is for convergence issues. Now, this is the kind of cool slide in which you can see the evolution of the estimation over the stages. So if you look at, this is for finding the left wrist. So at the beginning, the system actually thinks it confuses the right wrist with the left wrist. So it kind of finds it there. The reason for this is that obviously in terms of appearance, they look exactly the same. But because we're actually also using this 3D information, then the skeletons are also used, they're being very useful to guide the 2D predictions as well. And in the end, we end up in the correct position. And you can see that through the stages, we're improving our estimates of where the left wrist are, and also the 3D estimates as well. We're getting a much better 3D as well. Okay, so here are some results on the human 3.6M data set, which any of you working on human pose will know that this is the data set that everybody has to evaluate their algorithms on in computer vision. So you've got some, you know, this is a mocap studio, and the reason why we evaluate on this is that we've got ground truth data for these sequences, so everyone can compute their errors. And at some point last year, we were still like the top performing method. We were beating everyone else. I mean, unfortunately, that's probably not the case anymore because this field moves incredibly quickly. But you know, more importantly for us, I think the most important thing is the fact that this algorithm can actually work in the wild, that it can take images from anywhere, and you can get some very reasonable poses. And you can see here that this is actually doing a pretty good job on very hard poses. These come from the LEEDS data set, or the MPII, one of those two, MPII. But even more important, you know, what we really want is to be able to use this in completely different scenarios. So scenarios where we haven't trained at all. So we now have an EU project with some partners, so Ocado Technology is involved in this project, and this is their warehouse in Hatfield. And we've got people doing maintenance tasks, and we have to be able to track them, because a robot is collaborating with these humans, so the robot needs to be able to track their pose to be able to infer what they're doing. We apologize for the inconvenience. I used to write all my presentations in LaTeX until last year. And I thought,
They do it on purpose in the backs of Microsoft software on Mac.
Yeah, well, I should change the keynote really, but yeah. Okay, we were here. On to the next video. So this is actually, in fact, a live demo. So this works in real time. Again, this is the warehouse in Ocado. You know, these images are, I mean, you couldn't get worse images to work with. And still we're doing, you know, an amazing job of recognizing the 3D pose here. So this algorithm is, you know, now we can actually run it in real time, we can set the camera and we can track anyone doing these poses, so it's working fairly well. Okay, so, you know, I think what I've been seeing, you know, throughout all the years that I've been working in computer vision is that I never actually imagined that I would be able to get to this point where you can just get a camera pointed at a person. I mean, this person's wearing markers, but we're not using the markers at all. The only reason is that we were comparing with a mocap system that they had there, but we weren't. I mean, not even in my wildest dreams would I, you know, ever have imagined that we could get to this point. So, you know, I mean, really, you start to think, and is computer vision actually starting to really work? And I think, you know, that those of us who've been in this community for a long time, you know, we're amazed at the progress and, you know, where we are right now and the opportunities that can be taken right now. So, you know, this is where I'm going to tell you about something quite exciting. So Synthesia is a new company that we've started up, and most of the people are actually in this room. So with Victor and John, who's just here, John is CTO, Victor CEO, Stefan is here as well, and Corneliu, Mos was here earlier. So we've just started up this company a few months ago. So Matthias Niesner is also one of the co-founders, and he's responsible for the face-to-face system. Maybe some of you are familiar with it. So we really, you know, a great team of people who've been working. Some of us have been working in computer vision for a long time. And we've seen this technology just you know, flourish and come to the point where it really is starting to become to be ready for commercialization. So this is the kind of exciting, you know, the exciting time where we are right now. So this is the technology, and this is what we're trying to build right now. Well, no, we're not trying, we're actually doing it. And you'll see a video at the moment to show that this actually works. So, you know, forget about what I said before about being completely unsupervised and model-free. So, you know, if we know that we're tracking faces and we're interested in faces, then, you know, let's use models and let's track faces using models. So what we're trying to do here is video editing. And we want to take an input video and we want to produce an output video where we've modified the video in some way. And in this case, what we want to do is that we want to transfer the mouth movement and the facial expressions from one person onto another. So you're going to see a video right now of this. So there's Victor over there, who's just sitting here, and Hillary. And you can see that now Hillary, all the expressions in her face are actually, you know, the facial motion that Victor is doing is very, very serious there. But you can see that, of course, you know, we can move the mouth, we can move the eyes, you can see the eyebrows are going to be moved right now. There you go. So, you know, now we've got this amazing technology where, you know, we're tracking this video, and we're actually tracking the video in 3D, so we're producing a 3D reconstruction of the video. And because we have a model for the face, we can actually transfer facial expressions and movement from one to another, and then we can resynthesize a new video. So, of course, what's exciting about all this is the number of applications that it has. So, you know, for me, you know, I'm amazed that we can solve this problem, that we can do it. That's already great. But, you know, the areas that we really want to influence are, for instance, the film industry, and in particular the dubbing industry is the industry that we're very interested in. So if we could, for instance, translate, you know, some films into another language, and, you know, the mouth is actually moving correctly rather than, you know, I don't know, I'm Spanish, and when you watch a film in Spain, the lips are always doing something completely different. It's the worst thing in the world. So, you know, we think we can do a lot in that direction. But more in general, you know, really our mission is to solve video synthesis and to be able to really edit videos and have much, much more freedom in the way that we can edit videos. And videos of things that are deforming. So that's why it's so exciting for me. So if you're interested in this, and you know, there's quite a few of us around here, so do come and talk to us. I'm not sure if I've got any, do I have more time or? No? Yes? Okay, I'll just talk about one more thing. I promise I would also talk about this Dynamics LAM system. So, you know, I have to say that working with people who work in robotics is actually, you know, has been a very sobering thing for me, because, I mean, things have to work, right? They have to work, and they have to work, you know, they want them to work all of the time. You then go and tell them, no, but you're a robotics person, you know, I'm a computer vision person. It doesn't work all the time. So I think, you know, it's been really great for us and for my group to work with roboticists, in the sense that it has actually led us to think about, okay, how can we actually, you know, make a demo that really works. You know, I showed you just before the human pose estimation. I mean, that was actually working with a camera in a warehouse. The same goes for this. You know, things have to work and they have to be robust. So this is really what motivated the work. So if you think of most SLAM systems, I would say any SLAM system, the most basic assumption that's been made is that the world is static. So the world is static, and there's nothing that's moving independently from the camera. And if it is, then these are detected as outliers and they're kind of thrown away. So we don't pay any attention to things that are moving independently. But if you're in a warehouse environment, you know, there are lots of things that are moving around. And so if you just apply a normal SLAM system, you get reconstructions like this, where the moving things are just ignored completely. And instead, you know, what we want is to actually discover things that are moving, to be able to track them, to be able to fuse them, to be able to get their geometry, and to be able to segment them from the background. So this is exactly what our system does. So, it's very, very simple in some way. So we take a new frame, we track all of the objects that we have independently moving, and then we segment. And the important thing is that this segmentation algorithm can be based in many different cues. It can be based on motion, so that we can track things that are moving independently from the camera. Or it could be semantic segmentation, or it could be a combination of both. It could be geometric segmentation based on surface normals. So we could have many different cues going on in here. If we found a new label, so if there's a new object that's appeared, then we spawn a new model and we fuse, and then in the next frame we'll have more objects to track. So it kind of looks simple. I mean, it's actually, the really hard thing is to get it to work in real time, implement it on GPUs and everything. But this is where, so Martin, my student, has been absolutely amazing. So here you can see a scene where the camera is moving. The chair is obviously moving independently from the camera. And this is the result that comes from a traditional SLAM system. So you see that we haven't actually detected those as outliers. If you don't, then the geometry is all messed up. And of course, this is the output of our algorithm. So we've called it CoFusion. And so we can segment and we can track objects that are moving independently. And we can continue to fuse. So you can think of this as a Kinect fusion, but for things that are moving, right? So you can still keep track. And the nice thing is that, you know, if things are moving and brought into the scene, then, you know, we can assign a label. So this is object one, this is object two, this is object three, and we can keep track of those. And these objects appear in the scene and we can keep tracking them. But of course, so far, these labels don't mean anything at all. They're just, you know, object one, object two, or blue or yellow. What we actually really want to do is to be able to assign a semantic label to these. And this is the recent work that Martin has done and that I showed a snippet of at the beginning. So now we're doing something which is a lot more cool. Now we take the video, and in the video, we're actually running an instance level semantic segmentation algorithm. So this is actually mask our CNN. So we're running this, and now we can actually segment all of the pixels, and we can assign labels, you know, and we're getting very, very nice segmentation from those from mask our CNN. But we're also getting labels. And the other important thing is that this is an instance level semantic segmentation algorithm. Therefore, you know, if we had two people, we would know that one is person one, the other is person two. So what are we doing here? So we're actually reconstructing the scene. The things that we recognize, we then assign labels in the 3D map. So you can see the 3D map here. We also recognize that a human is interacting with the scene. So there's a hand that appears at some point here. So we have the person label. And we see that the person is interacting with the scene, picking up an object. And because we can track moving objects, we can also track this independently. So again, this is something that we can demo now. Unfortunately, we need a machine that's got two GPUs, so I wasn't able to bring it with me, even though my office is just a few meters away. But anyway, this is, you know, for me, this is really quite exciting. I mean, this means that, you know, we can use all the power of deep learning and all the power of 2D, you know, being able to use all these 2D labels. So someone's trained a system based on 2D labels to give us semantic segmentation. Of course, that would be incredibly hard to do in 3D. You know, it would be really impossible to do a kind of a learning job directly on 3D labels because they're just not available. But instead, we're able to use this learning output from the image and to transfer it into 3D. And that's, you know, incredibly useful. Here's just another sequence with a few different objects. The teddy bear just, I don't know, they appear, all these soft toys, I'm not sure why we're a bit fixated on soft toys. They're deformable, that's why.
Furry,
yeah. It's got nice geometry, good to track, yeah. Keyboards are good to track as well. They've got like little bumps, so they're good geometry. Flat things are very bad to track. Anyway, so okay, so that takes me to the end. So so I've kind of shown you these recent advances in computer vision that allow us to deal with dynamic scenes, right? And I've shown you maybe, you know, two different sides of the spectrum. On the one hand, these optimization-based methods that are, you know, they're great because they're unsupervised, so you can just turn your camera on and no matter what sort of object you have, you'll be able to do something. And I'm still really incredibly interested in that problem because of this. This is the reason why I'm very interested, because, you know, there's huge potential on video processing right now. So, you know, I think this is really the untapped part of machine learning. So being able to learn from unstructured internet video libraries. So, you know, we go to YouTube, there's loads of videos, but the videos could be of anything, and often they don't have any tags, you know. So we really need to be able to combine some semantic, maybe information, some recognition with dynamic 3D modeling. I mean, that's really something that we have to do. I'm also, of course, you know, always very keen to go back to this idea of being able to make this a commodity, right? Can we get to the point where we can just get our phones out in the same way that we take pictures, or the same way that, you know, we can do some apps where we put some funny things on our faces? Can we actually get all the way to 3D? You know, could we do something like transferring my expressions to Hillary Clinton just with our phones? You know, this is really a very interesting area of application right now. And, you know, again, I think using this for robotics is really a very interesting application. So, you know, the other area in which, of course, I'm, you know, very keen to keep working on right now is this adventure with Synthesia, with our company. And, you know, it's really quite, again, I would say sobering. You know, when you start looking at things from the industry point of view, again, things have to work. You know, it's a bit like robotics, I guess. Things have to work, and people want different things from you. They might not want your algorithm to be real time. They might actually want it to be, you know, very, very accurate. Or they might actually want it to be very flexible so that they can, you know, do a rough estimation and then they can do the rest. They can do the rest of the editing. So, you know, we're now collaborating with quite a few partners you know, trying to design where we're going to go, where we're going to go next. And, you know, so far we've got amazing feedback of our technology, and I think that, you know, we can probably attack many different directions. This is the feedback that we keep getting all the time. So it's really exciting times, you know, for going from academia to industry and moving things to industry. And finally, you know, I just like to, you know, I'm still a researcher at heart, and these are the guys who do all the hard work and who pull the all-nighters to get the papers in, and obviously the funding bodies that have funded this research. So thanks to them. Yeah. Probabilistic PCA. If you've already got 2D detections, that's fine. You can just lift them into 3D. So, I mean, sometimes that's what we do. We actually get the detections from another algorithm, and our 3D model can do that, and it's very good at that. Yeah.
A couple of questions. First, the algorithm you showed, which extended the First World War, but using shading.
Yes.
How fast is that algorithm?
How
long does it take to process one image, for example?
Yeah, that one's definitely not as fast. This one is, I don't know, maybe half a minute per frame. Maybe less than that, actually, maybe 20 seconds, but it is in the order of seconds. But this has no GPU acceleration, and also actually, yeah, no, it's, I mean, yeah. For instance, if you write the Jacobians, and we're using Ceres for the optimization. It's all GPU based, so it's not fast at all. But if you worked on it, you could get it working in real time.
And the other question I had is, any effort to try it, like the CoFusion work is using like a dead camera, right?
Yes.
Any effort to try to get it like on a monocular camera, like with similar ideas to the first kind of?
Yeah.
Not yet.
We're working on it. We're working on it, but that is a super hard problem to solve. Because when you've got a single object, then you can actually think about building a template. When you've got a complete scene, then it's much, much harder. But I don't know if you've seen some work that we did in ECC V14, video pop-up.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the direction in which we went, but that wasn't fully dense. It was actually more, you know, just tracking features, and it was sparser. But
maybe just make like the models for certain objects, not the complete scene.
Yeah. So I mean, that's the reason why, you know, this semantic segmentation The interesting thing is that you can actually select the labels, right? You could say, I'll just bring it back. You could just say, okay, I'm only interested in bottles and keyboards, so, you know, and so you could just select the kind of labels that you're interested in and not worry about the rest. Yeah, so this is something that we're already doing. So in this case, for instance, we said, okay, we're only looking at teddy bear and vase and bottle. And also, we're ignoring, that's the other cool thing, that you can ignore motion. So when the hand comes in, we're not tracking the hand at all. We're just saying, okay, ignore these pixels completely. So semantics are really, really useful.
Direct evidence for the template that you have mentioned,
yes.
Like if there is an error in the template, so that error, like in the last function, that the error is being propagated.
Yeah, so at the moment we're not improving the template, but that's something that is a really interesting thing. So, you know, can you also optimize the template as you go? So a bit like, you know, you could do, yeah, maybe an optimization that's maybe more related to dynamic fusion, but obviously, you know, dynamic fusion also has the depth channel. We don't have the depth channel, so they're kind of estimating the template at the same time as the deformations. Yeah.
Are you using any kind of surface like in a template, like instead of I think you're using this polygonal mesh.
It's a mesh, yes. Sorry, I'm not sure what you mean by surface.
Instead of using a polygonal mesh, if you use like local surface, like.
Yeah, I mean, you could use different representations for the geometry, definitely. Yeah, or you could use a volumetric representation, but yeah, we haven't done it yet. But that's, you know, that's an important question. You know, what representation is the best to represent surfaces?
So if you want to do this a very impressive dynamic slam, right now your focus isn't using commodity hardware, so it's just doing all the magic with one single camera.
Mm-hmm.
So if you said, okay, well, actually I'm going to use a dead camera, how much easier or how much better would the results be with that extra information? Would that help you?
This one?
Yeah.
This one uses a depth camera.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, it's
okay.
An RGBD camera.
Right.
Maybe I didn't say it at the beginning.
Yeah, I was actually going to ask you that question because I thought that most examples you were showing, you were not decided not to use that.
Yeah.
Is that
no.
correct?
That
this
makes,
one, yeah,
that
the
makes,
video.
Makes
the
a lot of sense, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
okay,
yeah,
yeah.
I mean, if we manage to do this with a single RGB camera, I think we would deserve the Nobel Prize or something like that. That's, I mean, it's much, much, much harder, much harder. I mean, the thing is that you need a good baseline to be able to reconstruct and clean these kind of places. Yeah, we've been working on this for a long time, and doing full scenes is a lot harder than just concentrating on a single deformable object. But I think, you know, there's a lot of, for instance, segmentation. Being able to do segmentation on the image directly is something that helps enormously. And it's only now that, you know, we really can do these things. And, you know, you could do things like, if you detect these boxes and you've actually got a 3D model of the box, you know, you could say, okay, you know, this is the box that I have, and then you can start tracking using model-based approaches.